these questions you already know how large a role the question is in the discussed experience of the exam. In the short time that I have this evening, I want to condemn three things to you. That the gardens were an integral part of the original conception of the exam, that they were and are the product of a creative collaboration between scholars, curators, educators, and practicing horticulturalists like myself. And above all, that the gardens constitute a living collection that is as important and as significant as the museum's renowned collection of medieval art. Many of the platforms represented in the urban architecture of the cloisters grow in the gardens. And one of the special pleasures of the cloisters has always been to move from gallery to garden and back again, enjoying the juxtaposition of art and nature. There are three gardens of the cloisters, each of which has its own character. This is called the cloister guard garden on the upper level of the museum. It is the type of garden that you would have found at the school to the south of the church. In an medieval monastic complex, a place which provided a sheltered, sunny spot where the monks could enjoy nature without leaving the confines of the monastery. Contributing a reconstructed Romanesque cloister, the design of the garden is typically medieval in its form and features, divided into quadrants by cross paths, with a fountain at the center of the garden. However, it is the only garden of the two that is not medieval species. As the principal ornamental garden at the museum, it has always been planted with a combination of medieval and modern garden plots to provide a wide season of color and scent. Although it is not strictly historical, since evidence for the planting of monastic gardens with herbs and flowers is lacking, the garden does ultimately derive from the pleasure gardens of the Middle Ages, with their borders of herbs and flowers chosen for daily fragrance. The cloister garden on the lower level of the museum was once planted as a landscape garden based on the second of the unicorn tapestries, the unicorn at the garden. The trees and shrubs outgrew the outcrowded space, and the garden is now planted as a single field of herbs and flowers, evoking the urban grounds of many of the unicorn tapestries, in which a myriad species are shown moving simultaneously. There are two views of Omaha's cloister herb garden. One in early spring and the other in late autumn. Bonaparte is on the lower level of the museum adjacent to pre-cloister garden. The famous and venerable constitutes and heavy fruit on the right were planted in the 1950s. Woodland plants that need protection from the sun are growing their shade. They are the exception to the rule that the garden is planted by the museum. We'll talk more about that in a few moments. Whether or not Bonaparte is the most beautiful, or the best beloved garden, it is unquestionably the most important as the main teaching garden and the home of the larger part of the medieval plant collection. Bonaparte has always been a place for private study as well as public enjoyment, and is the principal setting for the educational programs in which visitors are invited to explore the role of plants and gardens in medieval art. The plan of Bonaparte Garden is typically medieval, with its simple geometry, small raised beds, and central wellhead. But it is not based on any particular monastery garden. On the top left, we see a photograph of the garden was taken in the 1950s in midwinter. Below that is a contemporary photograph of the garden in early spring. The plants in the garden are labeled and assigned their beds by use. Whether magic, medicine, housekeeping, or industry, the beds too are labeled. On the upper right is a detail of a plan of the herb garden, in which medieval species are arranged ornamentally, as they were from the 1930s through the early 1970s. In 1976, the museum hired John Williamson, a landscape architect, to redesign the garden, and he was responsible for a scheme in which the plants were assigned to their beds by use, as we still do today. On the lower right is a plate from Conny Byers' book on the Cloisters Gardens, Sweet Herbs and Summer Flowers, showing the designations of the beds in 1995, when the book was published. While the garden is still planted thematically, the beds are periodically revised and replanted. The artist's material bed is one of the most popular beds in the garden, and it's home to the three diagrams used exclusively to furnish all of the colors of the garden space. The matter at the top left was the source of the red, which was derived from the roots of the plant. The flowering tops of the wells in the center gave a yellow, and the fermented leaves of the stems, leaves and stems of the road on the right gave a blue. If you wanted to compound the green, you would mix the blue of the road with the Our working list of some 400 species known and used in the Middle Ages is based on monastic records, herbals, works of art and literature, and archaeological evidence. Here are two important medieval plant lists, which are the foundation of our own. Both date to the 9th century. The image on the left is an edict of the Emperor Charlemagne, decreeing which plants are to be grown in the imperial space, 89 species in all. On the right is the intricate of a famous garden poem by the Benedictine abbot Walfestrevo, who was himself a gardener, as well as a poet and a scholar. In the fortress or the little garden, he addresses the salutation to each of the 29 plants growing in his monastery garden and tells us their uses and meanings and how to grow them. One of the flowers apostrophized in Walfestrevo's poem and specified in Charlemagne's list is the white lily. After the rose, it was the most beloved garden flower of the Middle Ages and the most sacred of plant symbols. It was also a humble medicinal used to treat baldness, burns, and the bites of snakes and scorpions. And here you see it on the right in the herbal of the Middle Ages. On the left in a detailed account of the greatest pronunciation triptych on Robert Compound. Not all candidates for the recreated medieval garden are as easily found as the lily, which has been in continuous cultivation for 5,000 years. Sources for plants and seeds of historically appropriate species is an ongoing quest. James Rollmer, the first creator of the Cloisters, gave much time and attention to both the planning and the planting of the garden. The garden archives hold an energetic correspondence on the subject, including letters of inquiry sent to scholars and curators of monastic sites in Europe, asking for help and advice in the historical planting of the gardens. Rollmer approached Helen Morgenthau Fox, already a friend of the museum, in 1934, 4 years before the Cloisters opened to the public, and 1 year after the publication of the first of several books she wrote on herbs and herb gardening. Rollmer donated a copy of this work to the Cloisters, who see the book made on the lower right, where it remains on the library shelf in memory of his friend and colleague Joseph Breck, who was deeply interested in the gardens of the Cloisters in earlier times. Mrs. Fox was a noted authority who used her garden in Pittsburgh, New York as a laboratory to further her studies. An enthusiastic collaborator, Mrs. Fox provided sources far and undimensional for each of the plants on the list she eventually compiled for all. Some marked, I may have to give them to you. And the list ends with a generous promise, I will give you anything that rises in you. The 1930s were a time of great interest in historical horticulture in the United States. The gardens at Colonial Williamsburg were being developed under the aegis of the Federal at the same time that the Cloisters Margaret Freeman, associated for 52 years with the museum, first as a lecturer at the Old Cloisters in 1928, and later as a curator, eventually succeeded James Rollmer in 1955. She was the single most important contributor to the research on the medieval gardens and the development of the medieval plant list on which they are based. We have many notes and lists in her home in the gardens archives, as well as drawings. She would lay closely together a reproduction of a medieval artwork, carefully delineated the plants, and labeled images with the correct botanical name. She worked closely with the gardeners and kept careful records of the plantings. All this was of great value to Susan Moody, who oversaw the gardens from 1979 until 2007 in her extensive restoration and development of the gardens. And these records are still very much of interest to me today. Margaret Freeman published herbs that made the household in 1933, and her book on the Unicorn House was published in 1976 after her retirement, includes a chapter on the groves, the flowers, the fields, and the gardens of the Cloisters. And sorry to say that both of these books are now out of print. Perhaps the best known key to the flora of the medieval work of art was not called by Margaret Freeman, although she included it as an appendix in her book on the Cloisters. Two botanists working at the New York Botanical Garden in the 1940s, E.K. Alexander and Charles Woodard, were able to identify more than 80 of the 100 plants depicted in the tapestries. So great was the maker's fidelity to nature and the wealth of botanical detail. I'm going to focus on the circle of plants around the body of the unicorn, the key that we're looking at on the right. All of these plants are May blooming plants associated with erotic love and fertility, as was the month of May itself. Because of their associated folklore, they share the name of cuckoo flowers. The European cuckoo migrated to Africa in winter and returned to Europe in May. As many medieval lyrics attest, his song was the herald of that joyous month dedicated to love. Famously, the cuckoo rears its young in the nests of other birds and is the source of our word cuckold. Good for love, May was believed to be a very unlucky month to die. The association of the plants with sexuality was based not only on their season, but also on their physical characteristics. The satin, juicy stems of the bluebell, the smoky, twisted roots of the bistol, which is thought to aid in conception, the suggestive form of the cuckoo plant flower, also known as Adam and Eve or Lord of the Rings, and the even more suggestive form of the purple orchis or orchis master, were all indications of the plant's varying properties. This is one of three beds in Bonaparte Garden currently devoted to medicinal plants, and you see rhubarb, poppies, Douglas bluegrass, and other plants growing. And virtually all plants were believed to have medicinal properties in their edges. The medicinal virtue of a plant was believed to be manifest in an outward sign, to be read in its form, shape, or habit. The value of Viper's bluegrass as a remedy for snake bite, and that is the blue flower that you see here in the foreground, could be read in the marked semblance of its band flower based surface. Not all medieval medicinals have been the subject of clinical studies, but some of them have, and have been proven to have the therapeutic value assigned to them in the Middle Ages. Scholars now think that a given sign may have functioned as a mnemonic device for herbalists who had a practical knowledge of the plant's properties and did not necessarily derive their use from the sign. The cloisters are the only gardens in the United States in which visitors can see the great and famous plants of medieval medicine and magic in the flesh. The sign of the famous mandrake's power as an aphrodisiac and a love charm is in the humanized form of its forked root, a resemblance that was greatly exaggerated in the Middle Ages. And here in a woodcut illustration on the lower left, we see both mandrakes and woman grapes. It has taken the gardeners of the cloisters many years to establish the mandrake. In the 1990s, we were successful in germinating mandrake seed in cold frames, but the seedlings languished once transplanted into the garden. On consulting the garden archives, we discovered that the cloisters gardeners had the same difficulties in mandrake grapes. The mandrake has finally made a home for itself in Bonaparte Garden and bore fruit for the first time last year. If you are a gardener, you will know that a plant that is far from its native home may put out vegetative growth but be reluctant to reproduce. And mandrake is native to the East. I did include an illustration on the upper left, which indicates the proper way of involves the use of a bow. It's a very, very complicated story, and I don't want to take the time to tell it, but I promise that if you come to the process, I will give you all the details. I will tell you that it was a dangerous business to pull out the root, that you substituted the dog, and that dog paid the consequences. This is my favorite teaching tool in the whole garden. The concrete is called Paris, and it's in a barrel, also known as driving barrel. This plant was used both to conjure up snakes and to prevent snake bite occurrences. It is fly pollinated, and mimics both the color and the smell of water meat. The strange form and sinister aspect of the little dragon impresses even the most skeptical modern behaviors, however scientific their expectations. No one who has only seen the dragon on the roof of a medieval garden, or even in a photographic field guide, can really feel the full force of an Aaron's medieval association with snakes, sexuality, and death. When confronted with the bizarre reptilian markings on the sheaths of the 5-foot stems, the large bat-like wings, and the fearsome stench emitted by the enormous flower with its suggestive form and blackish-red color, we understand the medieval point of view. In this and other instances, a physical encounter with a plant can illumine whole realms of medieval experience and bring outlines and descriptions to birth. This is the inestimable gift of the Cloisters Gardens. Empirical knowledge of individual plants can open paths into the life, art, and science of the Middle Ages, less well trodden than those through familiar texts of the ages. If we examine, touch, and smell a plant, tasting it only with deep passion. If we familiarize ourselves with its habitat and its habits, we are much better able to comprehend medieval associations based, as it were, on the plant's appearance, texture, smell, and how it grew and where it grew. The recreated medieval garden offers itself as a realm of shared sensory experience and provides a fertile ground for the cultivation of a deeper understanding